When you think about the millennial generation, and now researchers are starting to talk a lot about Generation Z as the new name for this emerging generation, what are some of the words or phrases that come to mind for millennials? Selfish, lost, hipster, tech savvy, flake, late, okay, late. Gamers, entitled, foodies, self-absorbed, hopeful, lazy, over here, incredibly good looking. I like that. Say it again. Courageous. Okay, cool. Passionate. Sincere. Over here. One more time. Pressured. Yep. Unparented. Man, you guys have a lot of words. Good job. What was that? Overparented. I like it. One of the things that we find in our research is, let me start this way. First, one of the things that's so interesting is that you see so many negative words that are often thrown out as part of the description of this generation, right? Right? You've certainly heard some of the negative stereotypes of millennials, and we've said them here today, which is so interesting to me because it's usually. By the way, you know, there's so many different places in history, and you can see even in like an ancient Athens where people were complaining about the next generation, and you know, you sort of, this is like an age-old problem that we worry and we hand-wring about our youth, right? But here's, in the particular moment that we're in, it's so interesting to me because we have so many boomers and elders who complain about millennials, but here's my question is, who raised the millennials? Yeah, right. It's like we complain about handing out the trophies, but who handed them out? The participation trophies, right? One of my coworkers was telling me that her daughter graduated from, my oldest graduated from high school, and her daughter graduated from high school this last week. And we were laughing about the fact that at her daughter's school, they didn't do like a classic valedictorian. There were like 27 valedictorians. If you had a 4.0 for all of the, you know, 16 semesters of high school, you know, 4.0 or higher, it was like the true participant. It was like, we're just gonna call you all. You're all great. You know, that was great. All right, so we want to talk about this idea of this new generation. Let's see which one we got going here. Are we going off the back computer? Okay, cool. Again, thanks for your help with that. I know it's stressful to do that, but appreciate your efforts. Okay, so we want to think a little bit about this new generation and some of the generational tensions that are happening. And by the way, we just finished this big project called the Generosity Gap. And I'm not going to show you any of those particular findings today, but one of the interesting things that came out of that research was that there is this constant sort of state of generational battling that is happening in our churches, right? Like people are actually perceiving younger people, you know, as selfish and narcissistic, and they may well be, but there's this unstated thing that's happening between the different generations. And friends, one of the interesting themes of this work of Generosity Gap is it's more often the older generations judging the younger people than it is the younger people judging the older generations. In fact, younger people are often likely to give credit to the older generations as being the most generous and being, you know, sort of exhibiting really great generosity characteristics. But older individuals almost never say that young people are among the most generous or among the most hospitable in their congregation. So this is part of, I think, the work of Christian ministry today is to sort of demilitarize the generational warfare that happens in our churches. Now, as I mentioned, I've done a couple different book projects on this. We've interviewed tens of thousands of young people trying to understand their spiritual journeys. By the way, if you are interested in getting free email research releases from Barna, you can text the word Barna to 444-999. So if you're interested in getting free email research releases from us, you can text Barna to 444-999. So we give away a ton of free information to try to help equip you for this work, and you can text the word Barna to 444-999. Now, the spiritual journeys, where we want to begin today is talk a little about the spiritual journeys of this new generation. And so these are, part of my mission in trying to do this project called You Lost Me was to understand why young people walk away from faith, or more accurately, why they walk away from the church. So my work on this was to focus on that 59% of young people who had walked away from the church in some way. And what we discovered was that there was not the same, everyone sort of went through a different kind of journey. So prodigals are individuals who say they used to be Christian but are no longer Christian. That's about 1 in 10 young people who are prodigals. And that's the most heartbreaking because they actually deconvert. They go through as powerful or more powerful a journey as a conversion story. They deconvert from Christianity to something else, a non-Christian, an atheist, something else. And so they have gone through a very powerful process to say, I don't want to be defined any longer as a Christian. The most common is a spiritual nomad. About 4 in 10 young people fall into that category. And these are individuals who, sort of like my mother-in-law, are sort of lost to church. They still call themselves a Christian, but they're no longer very active as a churchgoer. And then you've got the group of people we call exiles, and these are individuals like that young Colleen that I talked to you about earlier, who said that she would like to know what the Bible has to say about selling her eggs. And young exiles, friends, are the ones who are going to be asking a lot of questions of how and if and why and should we believe this and what does it mean for us to have these kind of perceptions. Vince, would you mind grabbing me a bottle of water? Thanks, man. Why do we think these sort of thoughts? And they ask really hard questions. And friends, one of the first things you learn about exiles is that before you quickly answer in such a way that, you know, like you think you're going to answer the question, step back and say, Colleen, you know, you want money to sell your eggs, like, let's talk about what's going on in your life. Why are you asking that question, right? In some ways, they're not just asking what you think about the issue they're asking about. They're asking if you care. Right? That's an important thing that we learn about young exiles. And that's true of nomads and prodigals as well. So these are the three sort of spiritual journeys. And part of what we wanted to try to do by even showing you this information is to begin to think that every story in your church and in your family matters. So how do we not just assume that a huge number of these young people are going to walk away and end up becoming non-Christians? That's actually a very uncommon sort of journey. But how can we use good sort of spiritual listening to the spiritual stories of these young people? Now, another aspect of the research that we did really tried to focus on the reasons that young people leave, why they leave, and we came up with these 6 different sort of categories of response, that the church was overprotective in terms of culture, that it was repressive in terms of sex and sexuality, that it was anti-science, that it was exclusive, that it forced people to choose between their faith and their friends, that it was doubtless, that people were unable to express their deepest doubts in church, which, by the way, doubt is not antithetical to faith. It actually helps produce faith, as we see, especially in Christian schools, that one of the really good things that happens in Christian schools is that young people admit to having doubts, and they're able to sort of wrestle through those doubts in a safer place. Which, by the way, goes to some of the pedagogical renewal issues I was talking to you earlier. Sometimes it's so important for us, you know, to have a place where in a classroom-style setting or with a group of people that we're with for hours on end, we are able to sort of talk through and work through some of these issues. The sixth thing here is that their experience of church is shallow. So here's what I want to sort of observe about that. When this project came out, The book released, I think, 2011, and I did an interview on National Public Radio, and a young woman was doing some prep work for me. She was sort of working with NPR, and they do a lot of pre-work to make sure you sound like you know what you're talking about in the 5 minutes they give you on air. And it was cool because this young woman says, man, I've read your book a couple times, which doesn't always happen on Christian radio, I'll just say that, where they've fully read or understand the argument of your work. But so she says, I've read your book a couple times, and it seems to me that what you're saying is that life is getting more complicated, but for these young Christians, their experience of Christianity doesn't allow them to believe that Christianity is a deep, thoughtful, challenging response to the world. I was like, that is amazing, right? That is, I don't know if she was a young believer. She could have been. I sort of expect because of the odds that she had some sort of Christian background. But she was articulating, look at all the words on the right, overprotective, overparented, repressive, anti-science, exclusive, doubtless, shallow. It's like Christianity is anything but those phrases. But the experience of young people who, the 59%, right? Let's not forget, this is now a majority experience. Even in really good churches, you will lose a huge percentage of young people to the world, and Jesus says this is going to happen, gives us the parable of the sower, and the seed is going to land on rocky ground, and the parable of the lost sheep. Remember, Jesus says even if one out of 100 were lost, you should leave the 99 and go to find the one. But we're losing 59 out of 100 sheep. And we keep just, all right, well, it's their problem. They're just narcissistic and selfish and like, this is the question I'm asking you. Is our theology, is our approach to ministry strong enough and robust enough so that the general experience of Christianity, of course there will be some people who lose their way along the way, but why do we justify that? One of the things that I so often hear from pastors, I'm sure none of you in this room have ever said this or thought this, But you know, I'm going to talk in a minute about the changing demographics of this generation. One of the things we so often hear from pastors is that we shouldn't worry about this generation of 20-somethings because, well, you know, they're not maybe married now, but they will come back to the church when they have children and get married. Like, that is a really lame excuse for not focusing on people who just don't fit the target demographic of your church. All right, it's getting kind of quiet in here. So these perceptions exist, and again, I want to just remind you that my job here isn't to tell you or to preach at you or to chide you. It is to challenge you to realize that people are experiencing Christianity. They are experiencing a truncated, anemic version of the gospel in many of our churches, even in really good churches, and that you have hard work to do to disciple in a digital context, disciple in this new digital Babylon context. Now, let me explain a couple of things. I said to you this a minute ago that one of the perceptions is that young people really aren't that different, that this new generation really isn't very different from the past. I'm going to go to the slide, what's different about millennials? I think I'm just going to have you guys operate it from the back here. So what's different about millennials? So one of the questions that I have had very frequently is this question of, well, you know, we went through the 1960s. Again, people will just come back when they have children and get married. But we're living through a real fundamental shift of how we think about young adulthood. And the next few minutes, I want to explain what that looks like. First, let me show you one infographic that has no numbers at all, but I think illustrates the difference between the 1960s and today. Think about trying to have a mainstream, unified perspective on anything today. This is just a small little picture of the reality that we're living in, right? There is a proliferation of voices and opportunities and media channels, and you know, like we've created all these niche groups and tribes about the individual, and so this is one of the realities. This is just a little picture about why the 1960s were in fact so different. Why the generation of boomers, you know, of course, it was a challenging time in the 60s. The sexual revolution and many things have come to, you know, we're beginning in that time. The millennials are now sort of reaping what the boomers had sown. Another way to look at this, here's another infographic without any numbers, but this is why things are different even in the last two decades. The best human inventions are now in our pockets. When I started at Barna Group, Nancy Barna, George Barna's wife, bought me a Rolodex, We do not buy our new employees Rolodexes today. For those of you who are younger, what that was, you used to write down phone numbers and contact information so that you could remember it, and you would alphabetize it with the little blue tabs that are sticking up. All right, so I mean, just think about the changes that have happened in the last 10 to 20 years in terms of the way we do ministry and the way we just do life, right? So this is changing people's, remember we said in digital Babylon, things are accelerated and frenetic. The idol is being up to speed and being informed. I was driving one of my kids home, and there was a Kelly Clarkson song on the radio, a pop singer, and I didn't recognize the song, and I said, is this a new song? And my daughter was like, no, this came out earlier this summer. This is like old news. This instant, like, you know, like I'm out of touch because I didn't know this song has been out 3 months now. How about the fact that my sister, she got me one of these throwback Atari systems for Christmas a couple of years. They were actually sell these now, these nostalgic versions of these games. And my son opened the box with me, and on the back it showed all the old games that we used to love playing together when we were growing up. My sister, who's just a few years younger, I'm 43, my sister's 40. And so what games did you like to play on Atari? Pong, Missile Command maybe, River Raid, Pitfall, you know, like all these great ones. So they're all on the back of the box. My son was like, he's like, man, look at all the apps that come preloaded in this thing. They plug it into my dad's TV at the holidays, and it kept their attention for about 10 minutes. And I kid you not, when he got to Pong, he said, Dad, how did you live with these graphics back then? Well, we had to play it in the snow, you know, that sort of thing. All right, so here's another fun memory. My dad grew up in Phoenix, Arizona. Or he grew up in Cleveland, Ohio, but then moved to Phoenix. And I was remembering this recently, how he's a big baseball fan. And growing up, in Phoenix, they would never show you the sports scores of any. They would show you the Dodgers and a couple of on the nightly news, right, at 10:30 something. And but in order to figure out, just think about this, in order for my father in Phoenix, Arizona, to figure out whether the Cleveland Indians had won the ball game, he would either have to wait until the next day when the newspaper arrived, or I remember this now, we would call this really creepy 1-800 number and listen as all of the numbers were just, all the scores were just read aloud to you. And if you zoned out and it was like, wait, did Cleveland win or did the Yankees win? I can't remember. You had to listen to the whole stupid recording again. Like, just think about access. Like, that is what is happening, is this sort of real-time experiment on what it means for us to have immediate access. You can see this new slide here up here. This is one of the major demographic shifts in our time, that people are taking a longer time to go through these major life events. People unfairly call it a failure to launch. That is a wrong way for us to think about that as Christians. But this notion that people would have left home, finishing school, being financially independent, getting married, having their first child. In the 1960s, the vast majority of people had completed those major life transitions before they were 30, all five of those major life transitions. But you can see today, young people are much less likely to do that. So just think about, the majority of young people today aren't your typical, like, married adults. If you're going to have an effective ministry to 20-somethings, you're going to have to think differently about this. And let me just remind us that the idea of being a teenager is actually a relatively new idea in human history. For most of human history, you know, as a teenager, once you reach sexual maturity and once you were able to work on the farm, you know, you were an adult. You were considered adult. Even the Jewish traditions of bar mitzvah and bat mitzvah, you are an adult at 13. And what has happened is we created this category of being a teenager, and you're sort of in between being an adult and being a kid. And we've been very innovative, I think, in youth ministry around that over the last 100 years. We've created youth camps and youth publishing and youth ministry and youth pastors. But now we have a continued extension of that trend, in young adulthood. And friends, this is my critique, and I don't mean this with cynicism, but we are not as innovative with ministry to young adults today as we have been with ministry to teenagers. And there's one reason why this is true, at least. Why do you think that is? I think it's easier for us to minister to teenagers because we get their parents to come to church. It's much harder for us to be innovative in young adult ministry today because we don't have an economic reason to do that. My dad, amazing leader, has even said in years past that the reason he hires a youth pastor is to make sure that parents feel like there is a good youth option for their kids to come. And there is an economic reason to do that. And I'm not talking about this cynically, but I'm helping you understand. It is much harder today to minister effectively to young adults because they're much less predictable. Their lifestyles, their marriage rates, their parenting rates, it's all changing. And we don't have a script for this. But that doesn't give us an excuse, friends, to just say, well, let's just worry about them when they have kids. Does that make sense? What are ways we could do this? We could have internship programs. We could have vocational discipleship programs. We could talk about ways of creating helpful tools for them to think about faith and finances and other things that they're struggling with. Let me just show you a couple of facts around the ways that they're thinking about marriage. So what makes an adult? These are the ways that they think about what makes an adult. We ask people to define what makes an adult today. Marriage is 2%. These are 20-somethings, a stable job at 5%, becoming a parent at 5%, legal age 6%, financial stability at 20%, emotional maturity at 57%. Look, we're defining adulthood if you're emotionally mature enough to be considered an adult. So quick show of hands if you consider yourself to be emotionally mature enough to be an adult. How about this next slide? The top five goals of 20-somethings: to become financially independent before you turn 30, we want to be financially independent, finish education, start a career, find out who I really am. Remember that? 91% want to find out who they really are by looking inside. Follow my dreams at 31%. What's missing from this list? Marriage, family, faith? It's all about their own achievement, who they are, their own CV, right? We ask people, millennials want to be married, 82% want to be married at some point, but this is a crack up. 70% of millennials say first they want to be fully developed as a person before they get married. Okay, if you're married today, I just want to do a quick show of hands. If you considered yourself fully developed as a person before you got married. So this is the thing, right? Ministry, effective ministry to today's 20-somethings is going to include trying to help them work through expectations. This is why I think Ecclesiastes, Lamentations, Song of Songs, the wisdom literature of Proverbs, why it's so important for us to show these sections of scripture so that in an age when this generation doesn't know how to find themselves, they can find themselves in scripture. Let's just think together about the implications even in terms of staffing and working, you know, alongside young people. We have about 20 full-time people at Barna. And we have more than half of those are millennials. We have a young company. And it's been my pleasure. I'm a huge advocate for millennials and for Generation Z through the work. And because I think that the church unfairly characterizes them in negative ways. And at the same time, it can be very frustrating to lead and to lead alongside young people. There are days where I feel like we have an infestation of millennials at our office and we should have the building sprayed. Again, I have just sort of a weird sense of humor, so forgive me. But like I feel like we just got back some like employee satisfaction data, you know, and you're just like, man, really? You know, like, it hurts, right? To figure out how people are feeling about your leadership. And so how do you think about this? And here's the thing we keep telling ourselves, those of us in our team that are trying to help move the company forward, is we keep saying, listen, many of these people are so green and they don't have often the resources. I think one of our 10 or 12 millennials is married. They don't have the relational resources to go home and say, here's what happened at the office today. How do I think about this? Why am I even doing this? We all have those questions. I'm the president, I have those kind of questions, right? But to have the relational, so we keep reminding ourselves, like, what would it mean for us to develop this person, to help them to grow? And so here's, again, I sometimes use these stories just as illustrations of things, but you know, a year ago this summer, we had a team meeting and I was gonna spend a couple of hours sharing our vision with the company and with the team. We have a couple of people, we have about six or seven of our team is remote, so we had people dialing in through screens, through a video conference, and we had about 12, 13 people in our offices in Ventura. And I noticed on the one side of the office, like every time I would say something or they were sort of like not quite with what I was saying. They would laugh at the wrong times. Or one time this one of the workers would say, well, is that awesome, Dave? And I'd be, yeah, that's awesome. And they go, you know. Come to find out they were playing bingo with my words and phrases. One of the lines had the word awesome on it, right? So they were trying to bait me into saying awesome. All right, not really awesome, and I didn't respond maybe exactly with Christ-like character in that moment. But here's what we did. Here's what we talked a little bit about was, here's an example. I just want you to understand the dynamics of this. So I took the three or four folks, and I was like, individually, I was like, guys, you really blew it. This is not the way to do it. We're not going to do this in this company. And they were apologetic. They were contrite about it. They were like, "We don't still quite understand because you have a good sense of humor and you don't take yourself seriously and you create a culture where we thought it was safe to do it." And besides, we used to do this in college and you know like it was just a way for us to actually stay engaged with what you were saying. Okay, well, let me help you with that. Let me help you with that one. See, the thing is, if you were going to a college or university and the professor, like, they actually work for you. But here's the thing, you're working for me and I get to choose whether you stay on the team. And the reason I use the same phrases sometimes, yeah, I'm a dork and I'm a very limited leader. But the reason I use the same phrases sometimes isn't just to annoy you guys. It's because I am trying to help to create a compelling vision of where we're going as a company. And like, you guys aren't the best performers in our company anyway. So I need you to like stay on top of where we're going. And like, if you need extra motivation to like make sure you understand the words that I am saying to you, You might not be in the right company because we're like doing complicated spiritual work, and you can sell paper for Dunder Mifflin if you prefer, right? So here's the thing: each of those three people, still with the company, they are doing much better today than they were on that day. They have grown a lot. I still have my frustrations, not just you're a leader, you know. But this is, I'm like, what would it look like for me to be patient and for me to say, you know, like, companies don't work the way your experience has led you to believe they might work. And this is going to, like, I have to grow to think about what are we trying to accomplish. And this is just, again, I'm telling you this story. I made plenty of mistakes in how I handled that. But the truth is that we have retained three millennial folks who made a bad choice that day. And I helped to maybe shape them a little bit more about what we are trying to accomplish as a company. And that's part of what I'm trying to say is, like, how can you take even more time? And I think this is true, frankly, even in our worship services, because there are things that we do and they're kind of like muscle memory for us, like riding a bike in our worship services. And we're sort of like, we just get on, we're like, okay, I'm gonna start doing the preaching, or I'm gonna start, and I don't think many people quite understand all the things that go into that. And I think there are times in our, even our worship services and in our staff meetings and in our interactions where we could say, I'm gonna just stop here and just explain why we are doing this now. And in as plain a way as we can, just say, like, this really matters. And there are ways that you could bring people up on stage, for example, that we talked about vocational discipleship. You could bring people on stage and honor and ordain them for ministry in the world and pray for them. And you could bring young people on stage and ask them to share of themselves. And maybe you could commission young people in your church to create little videos about the history of your congregation and to show those videos on Sunday mornings and engage people in the life of the church to explain what it means for us to live counterculturally together in this age of skepticism. Let me give you just another example of this. We're gonna go on to this next slide of ministry in an age of skepticism. when we asked young people about the kinds of information that they would be willing to share with the church upon visiting, a first name, 82%. We're going back, there you go. Last name at 53%, email address at 33%, physical address at 19%, phone number at 12%, their social media information only 6%. That's the most intimate, right? 15%, I don't want to share anything. How about this, ministry in an age of skepticism. This is a cover photo of a thing called Awkward Moments Children's Bible. We're going to wait for the screen to change. Here it is. Awkward Moments Children's Bible. So there's Noah's Ark, and there are the dead bodies floating in the water. I was presenting this a few months ago to a group, and one person raised their hand, and they said, I don't understand why Barna would publish the Awkward Moments Children's Bible. I'm sorry that my logo's up there. It just happens to be my templated deck. This is not Barna's. This is an artifact from our culture, which I am bringing off the internet to show you, to help you understand the complexity of ministry in the digital age. We talked about Google as our sex educator. We could also talk about Google as the thing that undercuts the authority of Scripture, that makes us think this crazy old book that has David and the foreskins, that has, you know, extraordinary stories. That's one of the illustrations, by the way. I'm not going to show you all, but this is the Awkward Moments Children's Bible. I want you to understand how much of all this is compressed here, right? Like you Google something about, can we trust the Bible? And we are now living in an age of extremism where people are actively working to deconvert us from a religious perspective. That is not brand new, but the size, the frequency, the channels, the opportunities that we have for our own children to be deconverted. Think of what it means for us to even be earnest today. That people are viewing earnestness as its own sign of being, like, weird. Do you know what I mean? Like even the notion of trying to, like from my heart, I want you to understand that I think this is not right, that people will say, well, what's your motivation? We did an interview, for example, with a young person who had walked away. She was a young nomad. And when we asked her about whether she had any friends, any meaningful relationships within the church, she said no. And I said, well, what about the youth pastor? That person is paid to be my friend, she said. See what I mean? Like, that's ministry in an age of skepticism. My question, this is on the next slide, what will it take for us to recapture credibility? What does it take for us to recapture credibility with this generation? My little story of Barna Bingo, like, again, I'm a very limited leader. My team can tell you that. I have this is scriptural. Like, I have no business running anything. You know, but God has chosen me in his sovereignty, as Daniel says in Daniel 4, that God is sovereign over the kingdoms of men, then he gives them to whom he wishes. And God in his sovereignty has chosen me to lead Barna for this time. And like, in my limited capacity, like, I have more credibility today than I did a year ago with that team. And you know, like, I still have so much work. We have so much work, but what will it take for us to regain credibility? Let me just show you a few things that we're learning about millennials and church engagement. We're gonna go through these next slides here just pretty quickly so you can keep your finger on the button. So we're gonna talk about, when we ask about what a church should be in the world, you did some visual polling, and we find that most young people select this image of a group of people in a small group setting, reading scripture. We actually find that millennials, we did a study in Scotland, and we found that millennials say they understand the Bible better when they discuss it with their friends and with others. Maybe even in our worship services, we could spend 2 to 3, 4 minutes just saying, hey, I'm going to read you the scripture portion. A church we attend, a church called Reality down in Ventura, they read scripture, we pray, and I think we don't do this, but I think we could, where we'd say, hey, for just 2 to 3 minutes, I just want you to spend a minute talking about what this scripture might mean to you. How do we change people's engagement with scripture? On the next slide, we could look at their attitudes about family. And we can see that many young people, they pick a sort of an urban tribe of friends. Only 42%, that is the largest percentage, but you can see it's less than a majority, pick this sort of family image. Look, 11% of millennials pick that sort of digital image of connected people, right? Like, also sort of like a bunch of avatars. And so you can see that. We did in the research some image testing, looking at the different kinds of sanctuaries young people would be most comfortable in. We found a lot of interest in sort of a range of different things, and the report, I'm going to show you how to access that if you're interested. The report shows the different sort of, if you have a lot of church experience and you're a millennial, the type of church you're most interested in. We found in this research a whole lot of things around nature that young people were interested in. They wanted the outside brought in and the inside brought out. And so we found a lot of things around church architecture and experience. You can see that this idea of a prayer garden and a walk was very appealing to young people, as opposed to some of the other things that we looked at in terms of images. I'm going to skip ahead to the Making Space for Millennials image. So we did a whole bunch of research on this, and if you're interested in that report, you can check out that website, Making Space for Millennials. It talks a lot about architecture and leadership and other kinds of things that we believe are important. Okay, so rethinking discipleship. Here is where I'm going to end our time. We're going to spend just a couple of minutes around what it would mean for us to disciple in digital Babylon. And we talked quite a bit about it this morning in the Good Faith session about these opportunities that I think we have. I want to emphasize that. What an incredible opportunity that we have today to speak for the reality of Jesus in our lives. It is more complex than ever. It is more challenging. We should be feeling pressure. If we're not feeling pressure, we're not actually alive. But I am so excited about what the church can do today. And I wanna, all the thinking and the research, we believe there are sort of these at least 5 guidelines and guardrails. These are not like easy formulas for ministry, but you should be thinking about looking at your, maybe it's like, the soundboard in the back. How can we turn the dials of these 5 things up in our churches? If you could do that, you will be more effective in discipling in digital Babylon. Number 1 is meaningful relationships. Can we ask young people, do you really have someone in this church who is a friend, someone who you could count on in a time of crisis? You know, my oldest daughter's going off to college, and like, does she have people in her life who aren't just her parents who believe in Jesus? What kind of meaningful relationships will our own children have? Will the children who graduate from your church, will they have? Cultural discernment. Here's the simplest way I could explain this. I've been talking about some of these dynamics. When people in your church are more likely to watch reruns or shows, they will spend more time watching television shows than they will be listening to your sermons, right? The problem isn't the volume of those shows. The problem is whether we have an interpretive grid to understand how to respond to that, right? So watching The Office, if you know what that is, it's a sort of a snarky look at office dynamics. Watching The Office isn't the problem. The problem is when you think that's like normal life and that that's funny and you should try that. We were talking about this in our own family about cynicism and snarky humor in entertainment. And one of my daughters was saying that she realized we used to watch a show called Good Luck Charlie, a sweet little show about family dynamics. And she said, I realized that I tried to make jokes in our family, like I saw that family make jokes, and they weren't funny. And I was like, well, that's a good thing, right? Because maybe those jokes aren't actually very, they're like, maybe they're condescending and cutting and biting humor that aren't meant to be in a real, like, normal family. But see, we end up modeling the things that we see. So here's the question. Does your preaching, does your teaching, does the ministry of your church help to build an interpretive grid for people, cultural discernment, so that they can live in the world but not be of the world? That's the kind of impulse that I'm asking you to think about there. The third thing is reverse mentoring. This would be the opportunity we have to lean into the great skills and gifts of the next generation. I could not lead Barna Group without the incredible, incredible contributions of this talented team of young leaders. They're pushing me and our business into places that I'm not always that comfortable with. I mean, I am, but like, I'm like, what were we gonna, oh, okay, that's great. That's a great idea. You know, that's the kind of reverse mentoring. Listen, if you're not giving young leaders in your church, in your work, an opportunity to make you look good or look bad, if it's not costing you something, you're not giving them real leadership opportunities. If you're not giving young people a real opportunity to make you look good or make you look bad, you're not giving them real leadership opportunities. When I wrote the book on Christian, this is just a quick little personal story. When I worked on the book on Christian, I was working for George Barna for about 10 years, and he kept saying, you should write a book, you should write a book, you should write a book, and then we came to the book I wanted to write called On Christian, which is going to have 6 chapters on the judgmentalism of the church, the hypocrisy of the church, the anti-homosexual character of the church, the fact that it was too political, like the, you know, the shelter, like all these negative perceptions, and we're going to call it unChristian. And I wrote George an email saying, you know, like this is the book that I feel like I'm supposed to write, but it's coming out as a Barna book, you know, and I just want you to, like, are you cool with this? And friends, I still have the email that George wrote back to me pinned on my wall, and George said, absolutely, you should put it out. The key is to support what you have to say with data. We don't want to sugarcoat or compromise any of the findings. We don't want to just sort of like, you know, make things up. But if you don't write this book, we can't be faithful as a company. And even more, he said, it would be better for Barna Group to be drummed out of business for softening or reshaping the truth than for us to choose not to write this. Now, I want you to think about this. I've been working with him for 10 years, so there was a lot of mutual respect that was happening there. But he had written like 38 books at that time. You know, like, that's a lot. It would be better for the Barna Group to be drummed out of business, cost me something, than for us to soften or reshape the truth. Right? Like that's amazing, the kind of confidence that he gave me to say, no, I would rather give up my platform to see you be faithful to what God is calling you to do. That's a huge question for us as you think about reverse mentoring, right? Young leaders, are you understanding what it means for you when someone gives you an opportunity, that they're giving you an opportunity to make them look good, not for our own benefit, but because, like what does it look like for you to be faithful when you're given an opportunity to lead? Vocational discipleship, we talked a lot about that in the first session, so I won't say more about that, but I believe it's one of the most important ways that we could experience effective discipleship in today's world. And then finally, and most importantly, a firsthand experience of Jesus. A firsthand experience of Jesus. A number of years ago, my oldest daughter, who's 18 years old, I was laying next to her in bed. She was just maybe 9-10 year old girl at the time, and as we laid there talking about things, I asked her just out of the blue, like, hey, Emily, how do you believe, why do you believe in Jesus? She might have been, even been a little bit older, 11, 12, but I asked her, why do you believe in Jesus? And she said, well, we read about him in the Bible, and I think that's why I believe in Jesus. That's a good answer. That's a good answer. We read about a lot of things in literature, and we believe that the Bible is like a special book. It's inspired by God. But we read about hobbits and other, you know, crazy characters. So like, do you have any other reasons that you believe in Jesus? And that stumped her for a minute. She sat there, or lay there and thought about that. I could tell she was really, the gears were turning differently on this question. And she said, you remember when we were praying about who to invite into a little home group that we were running, and we prayed and we thought that the Lord asked us to invite the Auerbachers, some of our dear friends, who, by the way, are supporting us wonderfully now through Jill's situation. And we felt like the God had brought this group of people into mind, and then we actually prayed for them, and like literally minutes later, we saw them at Home Depot. And we both looked at each other, and we thought that was a little miracle. It's like, that's why I believe in Jesus. I think that if you want a little extra credit, you could look at 1 Samuel 3 as an example of the process of Eli and Samuel, meaningful relationships, cultural discernment, reverse mentoring, vocational discipleship, Samuel's calling as a prophet, and a firsthand experience of Jesus. Speak, Lord, your servant is listening. Those are the kinds of things that we need more of in our churches. And this isn't just about the next generation. It turns out it actually helps us, all of us, to grow into the kinds of people that God wants us to be. So here is the question that I will leave you. It has been a pleasure to share these thoughts and ideas with you. As I said, I'm so hopeful about our opportunities to lead together across generations, generation to generation. But here's the question I want to leave you with is, do you love your traditions more than your children? We all have these ways of thinking and doing. It's just human nature, isn't it? We get sort of in our ruts. We think about the ways that we do this becomes more important than who we are doing it with. And that is Jesus, and that is each other. And friends, we need the EPC to be stronger than ever, generation to generation. We need the EPC, we need your churches to be more courageous than ever, challenging millennials, vocationally discipling them, equipping them for life in science and genetics and you know, art and TV and media and video games. We need young people equipped for ministry in all of those places, and we need young people who are faithful in their ministry and mission, both in the local church and as lay leaders in the church. And you can and you are doing this. But we need you to be willing to ask that question honestly. And maybe we could say, like, do we love our traditionalism and our traditions, you know, like the certain ways, not just that traditions are bad, but like, what do we love more? Do we want to see these young exiles faithful in this new digital Babylon? And of course we do. I'm going to invite my friend Vince up, and as I do, we're going to take a few questions and answers, and then as you think about maybe a couple questions you'd want to ask me, that'd be great. We're also going to, as Bill said, we're going to ask the younger leaders to come up and to be prayed over by more established leaders. I saw this done at a denominational meeting up in Vancouver, Canada, and it was just this beautiful and powerful expression of, I know that it's in your heart as an older established leader that you want to bless and commission younger leaders. I know that as younger leaders, you want to be faithful to what Jesus is asking this EPC community to be. So I look forward to that in a minute. We're going to take some questions. So let me pray as Vince comes up. Lord, thank you for our time together. Lord, would you just again seal in our hearts the things that you want us to take, that your very voice would be speaking to us, and that you would find us faithful in this response, that, Lord, speak, your servant is listening. In Jesus' name, amen.